Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Good morning. Thank you, Jesus. Yes. It's calling us to a higher place of prayer. Oh, stand upon me. Magnify His name. Lord, is calling us to a higher place of praise. It's calling us to a higher place of praise, to stand upon the promise and magnify His name. There are the people that worship that He reigns. Zion is calling us to a higher place of prayer. Zion is calling us to a higher place of prayer, to stand upon the mountain and magnify His name. Tell all the peoples and the nations that He reigns. Zion is calling us to a higher place of prayer. Oh, Zion is calling us to a higher place of prayer, to stand upon the mountain and magnify His name. Tell all the people and the nations that He reigns. Oh, Zion is calling us to a higher place of prayer. Oh, He's become my highest praise. Where all the time response to You is become my highest prayer. Oh, just to know You more, oh, is become my highest prayer. When all time respond to You. Good morning, everybody. How you doing today? God bless you. Be my highest prayer, just to know You more. Please let's share the video as we begin to talk to Jesus today. Just to know You more. Thank You, Jesus. All over Shiva, bala 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 bala. Lege de broko zoba, la bala 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 bala. Ele braga zaboko zobe ge de boje. Jege de braga la bala 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 bala. Jege le braga la boshiva. Oh, hallelujah. Thank You, Jesus. Father, we give You praise this morning. We exalt Your majesty. We worship You for who You are and for who You will be for our lives and our generation. And today we lift Your name on high, and we thank You for Your mercy and Your grace and Your loving kindness. We are so grateful. We are so joyful. We are so happy that we could see the breaking of a new day, and we give Him the glory that is due to Him. Thank You, Father, for Your mercy. Thank You for Your graciousness. Thank You for Your commitment to every generation. We are so grateful. Blessed be Your name forevermore, in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. I want to say good morning to everybody. It's so good to have you around today. God bless you anywhere you're watching us from. This is the Influence Church, and my name is Dipo Apanishile. I bring the word of the Lord to you this morning again. And I'm trusting God that God is going to bless you, going to impart you with greater level of stamina, you know, and energy in by His word this morning in the name of Jesus Christ. God give us an assignment late last year to pioneer this thing called His Influence Church, this work called His Influence Church right here in Medway, Chatham, Medway of the United Kingdom. And our assignment is to bring it to build up, you know, and to send out. Basically, what God has called us to do is to build a multicultural church whereby, you know, people are tailored towards ministry and maturity, you know, as far as the sins of Christ is concerned. And I believe that as we express the counsel of the Lord to you this morning, that God is going to envelope you with due level of strength and strategy, and God is going to bless you in Jesus' name. For those of us joining us on Miss Ella or Miss La, we want to welcome you to God's presence too in the name of Jesus. Let's go into the business of today as we'll be dealing with the concept of people and principles as far as this month is concerned. And today, by God's grace, I want to talk to you on the subject apostles at war, as in the act of conflict management, apostles at war. And I want to believe God that God is going to speak to us, you know, in the different dimensions as we discuss this concept in Jesus' name. I'm taking my text from Acts, or let me use the word case study, from Acts chapter 15 from verse 36. Acts 15 from verse 36. We'll read a few verses to us, then I do a bit of a recap of what we discussed on Sunday or last week Sunday, then we'll be able to navigate into this. Don't forget, this is a series, so I'm not under any pressure to be able to finish it at a go. Praise God. Bible says in Acts chapter 15 verse 36, Bible says, then after some days, Paul said to Barnabas, let us now go back and visit our brethren in every city where we have preached the word of the Lord and see how they are doing. Verse 37, now Barnabas was determined, mark that word, was determined. Don't forget in verse 36, it was Paul that said to Barnabas. Barnabas didn't say to Paul. Paul said to Barnabas in verse 37, then Barnabas was determined to take with him John Mark. Verse 38, but God, Paul insisted, mark that word also, insisted that they should not take with them the one who has departed from them in Pamphylia and had not gone with them to the work, because why they are together is to do the work. Verse 39 now said, then the contention became so sharp that they parted from one another. And so Barnabas took Mark and said to Cyprus. But verse 40, Paul chose Silas. You have to mark the word chose Silas and departed, and being commended by the brethren to the grace of God. And he went through Syria and Sicilia, you know, strengthening the churches. Praise God. Apostles at war is our discussion today. Now, last week, we began to talk about the concept of people and principles. And our goal is to let people understand and appreciate the fact that relationship is vital to our destiny. And on this concept, I'm not even talking about marital relationship. I'm not even talking about ministerial relationship. I'm basically talking about the fundamental friendship, which is the foundation to which all other relationship is defined. Because if you don't, you know, work on your friendship as a person, automatically it's your friends that are close to you that God uses for the long run to shape and to sharpen your life. You know, and it's important for us to appreciate that we're in a season today that technology has tried to replace the importance of friendship or relationship, or let me use the word intimate relationships in our lives. So last week I began to give us some levels of statistic about the loneliness epidemic, which is the generation of 14 to 24 years old, that there is a tendency in the next 10-20 years we're going to be struggling with health issues, not because the world is not developing or the economy is not developing, but because we replace human being, you know, with the technology. And we must learn to appreciate the place of people groups as we move in our walk with God. Then we're talking about the importance of intimacy, friendship, confident relationship. And I know there have been a bit of people that say it's not compulsory you have friend or close relationship in your life. Listen to me, God plays isolation in family. God is a God that chooses the family you come into, because God respects relationship. You know, David had relationship, Hushai the Hakite was his friend. Abraham has relationship. Jesus has relationship. Bible says in John chapter 11 that Lazarus, they sent to Jesus, said, Lazarus, your friend whom you love is dead. And Jesus decided to go after 4 days and raise Lazarus from the dead. Jesus did not raise anybody from the dead compared to the way he did for Lazarus. Why? Because this is not somebody that he has a spiritual connection with. He also has a natural connection with. If you want to ask this season, who are God's friends? The friends of God are people that keep the secret of God. The Bible says that we say the secret of God is with them that fear him. You know, the friends of God, Bible says in Job chapter 29, Message Translation, it says, in the days of my youth, when the secret of God was on my tabernacle, one version says, when the friendship of God was in my house. So the counsel of God, the intention of God, is for a man and a woman to learn that life cannot finish, life cannot expire without some dimensions of intimacy, relationship in our lives. And this is very vital because when you are in a season of your life, or when God is moving you to a new level, God is working on you. One of the things that God has found in my work with God that God loves to do is to make sure that when you can't even perceive the counsel of God is on specific areas of your life, it is the people that are close to you, the people that trust you, the people that are vital to your life, not people that you just value, but the people that values you in a similar way you value them, are the people that God find it easy to communicate with. For instance, now, like I said last Sunday, David would have lost it to his son Absalom if not for Hushai the Archite. Because in those days, you know, Ahithophel had something specific to offer to destroy the destiny of David. But it was Hushai the Archite that gave the counsel, that terminated the counsel, you know, of Ahithophel. So we must appreciate the importance of relationship. And I said also last Sunday that what are the easier way by which you attract relationship? Bible says in the book of Proverbs, it says, he that giveth gifts as many friends that he needs. That's one version that said this way. The easier way by which you attract people into your life is basically as a result of how much outflow that comes from you. The more you give, the more people you are able to attract to your life. And we said there are also other fundamental reasons by which, you know, fundamental factors that determine the people. And now there has been an ideology going on in the body of Christ today that people come to church to look for friends. It's true, but everybody even in church cannot be your friend. The same way everybody in a nuclear family cannot be the closest to you. So you must appreciate that when you find yourself in a people group, there are people that God created specifically with your DNA in their system. Hallelujah. And these are people that can run life with you. There are people that you can run seasons of different seasons of your life with without you getting tired, without you getting discouraged. So it's important for us to know this season that there is nothing called a new generation that God is raising without the place of intimacy among friendship. Intimacy is very important. Intimacy among friendship. We must appreciate that. We must honor that. Now, the major challenge now, which is bringing us to this dimension of discussion today, that there is no friendship that does not pass through the cycle of the life cycle. I call it life cycle because there is no friendship that will not be tested. And I said there are 4 dimensions to it. You must enter into relationships to be treated. You must have a sense of relaxation. I talked about the importance of friendship last week. Sense of relaxation and joy and peace among people that you know that you're friends. Sense of confidence. When you're with friends, you don't package. You don't do titles. You don't, you know, you don't hide your weakness. And they still respect and honor you in the midst of that. But beyond that, you know, relationship now get to a point whereby when you begin to increase intimacy, you must train each other how you should be treated. Then when you train each other, there is no relationship that lasts without a testing season. There will always be a test. It's just like you want to be a doctor, you have to write an exam, you have to be tested to be sure. And devil is the one that loves that. One of the ways by which it brings relationship apart is to test it. But when test comes, which is also part of the journey of faith, it helps us to enter into the fullness or to a new season of that relationship or that love life, you know, that God has brought into our lives. The way marriage is tested, the way, you know, ministry is tested, friendship is tested. And I'm talking more about people and friendship this season, not because I don't have capacity to talk on relationship and other dimension, but I discovered that this is the fundamental. This, if you can do well at the friendship level, if you can even just have one friend in your life, you know, with level of intimacy and consistency over the years, you won't find it difficult to get into the body of Christ and be the one to be causing havoc. So relationships are tested for you to be trusted. So the season of being tested, you know, is the season that is very critical as far as relationship is concerned, because when you are being tested as a relationship, you know, it unveils strengths and weaknesses, and it gives us capacity to know whether this relationship is really vital to our destiny. Okay, and that's why I'm bringing us this concept of apostles of war, and I'm bringing it as a, you know, as a definition of crisis management, because now we are found in scripture different circumstances of people, you know, that are close, that even aligned together, that destiny has called them together, that there is an option of God upon their life. They couldn't sustain relationship for a while, and it's amazing. It could be very discouraging. And I know that this case study that I brought before you today, brothers and sisters, is so difficult to discuss it, because my intention is not to separate or to give you an ideology that I prefer one more than the other. No, that's not even the counsel of God. But we have this, you know, in the scripture so that we can have something to learn about as far as conflict management is concerned. And I'm more interested in using this as a case study because we are talking to people that desire to mature in the spirit. So we're not talking about people that they are fighting because there's no food in the kitchen, fighting because of sin. Start so tomorrow. We're not talking about people fighting because you bought a car that is more beautiful than I am, or people fighting because you're married and you have children and I'm not married. You know, those ones definitely cause conflict in relationship, but they are more serious matters as far as relationship is concerned, even more than that. I need to say at this point, brothers and sisters, which is very important, and I want to please listen to what I'm about to say. Every relationship is easily tested when we enter into a new season. And a new status. Seasons and status are things that the enemy use predominantly to affect us or to test relationships in our lives. Seasons and changes in season and status. Just do an analysis of your life and you will discover that you gather more people or you lose more people when your season changes, because seasons has a way of storming, you know, any resources in our lives. You know, changing status as a way of testing or storming any relationship in our life. It is now our responsibility to make up our mind that we're going to stick, you know, with this person, we're going to stick, you know, with this season, we're going to stick with these resources that God has given to us. Don't forget that I said to us that when God is bringing relationships to our lives, is the one that ordains it. Now, this relationship we're talking about now, is God that ordains it. For instance, now Jesus was preaching one day. The Bible says his brothers and sister came to meet him, and they sent him a letter. His mom sent him a letter and said, "Your brother wants to see you." And he said, "Who is my mother? Who is my father?" It's everyone that does the will of God. In other words, the relationship that God brings your way, this friendship we're talking about, are people that God brings your way to encourage you to do the will of God for your life. You understand that? To encourage you to do the will of God for your life. Any relationship that does not encourage you to accelerate, to grow, you know, to apprehend the purpose of God for your life, it's not. And in this case study we've seen, we can see that in the life of Barnabas. Bible says Barnabas, you know, in chapter 13, now Barnabas in chapter 12 rather, Barnabas decided, let me give you the scripture, you know, chapter 11 rather, Acts chapter 11 verse 25, Bible says Barnabas went to Tarsus to look for Saul. So this is a guy that was looking for how to apprehend Saul and to bring him into the limelight of his destiny. He found him in Saul. In other words, he searched for him, he brought him back to Antioch, you know, and for a full year they met together in church and taught the large numbers of people, and the disciples were first called Christians in Antioch. That suggests to us that as far as a group of believers concerned, families concerned, they were tested and trusted. Their intimacy as a group was so sound that people outside us are calling them Christians. That's fantastic. But it's important for you to see at this point that the relationship between Barnabas and Paul are not casual. Number one, you must understand the personality of Paul. And I spoke a bit about personality last week. That Paul is a very strong-hearted guy. Even in Galatians chapter 1, he was saying that when God revealed to me, you know, my message, you know, to the Gentiles, I consulted no man. In other words, I did not seek any woman permission. So for Barnabas to come to Paul and say to Paul, "Paul, excuse me, come over here. I want to open my platform for you so that you can accelerate and improve and grow your ministry," you must understand that this is not a cordial relationship. And we must give acknowledgement at this point to Barnabas for having this ability, not just to, you know, to seek for, not just to know Paul. That's number one season, number one thing. Number two is to seek for Paul. Number three is to bring Paul, you know, into the church in Antioch and to give him and share the platform for him. That's what friendship friendship is all about. Friendship is not something you do in secret. You know, it's not a secret call. And because you cannot be into a friendship, one of the ways, vital ways by which you know that God has sent you to a man, or a man has been sent to you in intimate relationship, is that you are not ashamed of their weaknesses in public. You will not. You defend them. We know as at this time, the pastor Paul saw at those times was so terrible that even when you tell somebody that Paul is preaching, they still run away from him because they are really scared about this guy. But when Barnabas came, Barnabas from the Greek word is a son of encouragement. His call is to locate people, to locate destiny that is relevant to the season. And I'm praying for somebody at this point in the name of Jesus Christ, that no matter how hidden your call has been, no matter how hidden the grace of God upon your life has been, you have been loaded, God has been speaking to you, but you don't have a platform, you don't have an opportunity to express what God has placed in your spirit. What you need is a Barnabas, I'm telling you. And I'm praying that God will send Barnabas to you in the name of the Lord Jesus. I say again, God will send Barnabas to you in the name of the Lord Jesus. You need Barnabas in your life. There is no, but no matter how anointed Paul is, Paul needs Barnabas in his life. He needs a son of encouragement. He needs somebody that is full of the spirit of God and faith. He needs somebody that has entered into a dimension of his ministry whereby it seems naturally that he doesn't need an associate. He already has the platform, he already has the ability, he already has the funds, he is enjoying his ministry, but he has this ability that anytime that God placed me on a stage, placed me on a platform, does something new in my life, I am not supposed to be selfish with it. My job, my joy is to bring somebody that has capacity, you know, similar to what I have, to do this together. That's a Barnabas. So this guy went to seek for Paul. He brought him into a church and he opens the platform for him. The Bible says in Acts chapter 13 from verse 1, it said there were prophets and teachers in Jerusalem. And what was the job? They were just teaching the people, and multiples of resources, you know, the disciples was being raised. One of the beauty of that scene is that it allowed Paul to improve in his work with God. His ministry became more came to limelight. He was able to test the waters. He was able to use the gifting, the resources, the spiritual ability, the knowledge that God has loaded the spirit with over the years to bring him, you know, to bring the people into a dimensions, you know, bring people into a dimension that they can accelerate and grow into the knowledge of God, which is good, and we give it to him for that season. But there was a season in our lives whereby God said to them by the Holy Ghost, he said, separate Paul and Barnabas for the work of the ministry. The first season of their life in relationship, and you have to understand how seasons switch in relationship. Let me repeat to you again. I said to you that you must understand that every relationship must be tested for it to be trusted. Sometimes in 50 years, in 40 years, relationship can be tested per decade. You know, can be tested per decade. And when people, you know, could not pass the test of relationship, they lose relationship entirely. But when, and irrespective of your call, irrespective of your platform, irrespective of your exposure, every relationship that genuine in your life will be tested. Some of us, little things are testing. Oh, they didn't call me on my birthday. I don't think he lost me. He didn't buy gift for me. Oh, I was down. He didn't pray for me. Yeah, all those things are little foxes that destroy the vine. But you must understand that when relationship have been tested, let me even say this at this point, it's very important. You know, to say this at this point, I wrote something down that is very powerful that I need to read to you. It says, sometimes it is wiser not to join a relationship that you cannot preempt will last. Don't start a journey you cannot see the future. You understand what I'm saying? So Barnabas saw the future in this relationship, and he knew that a season will come that there might be a sense of partnership. When he met Paul, it might be that, okay, I'm the one in charge, I'm the one looking for you, giving you a platform. But a season will come, that will be a different season, whereby there will be a platform they will share together. Not just now as prophet and teacher, as Paul being teacher, Barnabas being a prophet, you know, Paul growing in his ministry. Said, but a season will come that there will be Paul and Barnabas assigned into an apostolic ministry. Are you listening to what I'm talking about? So we must appreciate that every relationship that we know that will not last, any relationship we can't see the future, does not mean what in the first instance to be joined, you know, to be part of. We must appreciate the importance, you know, of a future relationship. That's why when God brings people into your life, he brings people into your life for a purpose, for a season, and some of them for life. And when you notice that those relationships are with you for life, you must appreciate, you must pay the price to keep it together, to keep it working. Are you with me? Hallelujah. So you must, what we're saying to you, brothers and sisters, which is very vital and important, is that, brothers and sisters, every relationship that we test, Two major things that test relationship is changing seasons and status. I'm telling you, changing seasons. And I'm telling you, it has caused a whole lot of havoc repeatedly in the body of Christ. Hallelujah. Yes, you know, about two, three years ago, an old friend of mine was, you know, angry with me. And he just felt that, okay, I'm in the United Kingdom. I'm not paying attention to him. He's facing challenges here and there. And I was saying to him that, look, brother, we need to sit down and discuss this. The reason I couldn't call you or pay attention to this relationship is because I was facing a kind of prayer. Do you understand? And I'm trying to make sure I navigate my way out with accuracy and precision. But he couldn't understand until we sat down to discuss, for him to understand that everybody, irrespective of location, pass through season. And one of the things that season does is that when season changes, the enemy doesn't want us to bring the vital resources of the last season into a new season. You must understand that revelation is progressive. Relationship is progressive. There is nothing called a new season there's what we call a new season. But when you enter a new season, you must understand that there are things in the old season, in your last, that God is bringing to your now. Oh man, I like that. There are things in your then that God is bringing into your now. Some of us now, for instance, your season changes when you got married. But the relationship you are building in the university, the relationship you build over the years, do you understand? By the time you got married, you lose them because the relationship marital relationship you enter into now, the personality of the relationship is so dynamic that everybody just wants to be I and me, myself and my wife, or myself and my spouse alone. I have seen many relationships that have been tampered with simply because the guy got married to a lady that is not interested in the friends of the guy. Look, it doesn't work that way. If you make that decision in your life, you make a very terrible decision. Because you must understand that the relationship and the friendship that God brings into your life are people that are very vital. If they are not important to your life, they have contributed to your life to a point whereby that you have the ability to change status. And when you change status, you must understand that it's not status that builds relationship. It is personality and divine connection that build relationship. It's not how much you have now. It's not how big you are. You know, you've seen people in ministry that the only area they discuss, you know, is how much achievement they've made, the ministry, the country they've got to, the population and all of that, which are fantastic. But when God brings friends your way, it's got nothing to do with status, it's got nothing to do with just change of season. It's because this person has a resources, this person has a personality, this person has a grace, this person has a knowledge gap that you need that can sustain your life forever. Are you with me? Let me say it this way. Hushai the Archite was David's friend, but Hushai never became a king. So you can have a friend that will not operate at the same level of status and kingship with you. And you must recognize it. Only wise men keeps men. It keeps relationships that are not at the similar status with them. You can be a friend with somebody that is not as rich as you are. You can be a friend with somebody that is not as popular as you are. You can be a friend with somebody that is not as married as you are. You can be a friend with somebody that doesn't have children. So the definition of intimacy in relationship got nothing basically to do, you know, with it has a lot to do with personality, not with, you know, achievement or productivity. Yeah, that is an addendum to it, but having a new season in your life, entering a new season in your life, is not a license to cause some relationship to expire. And let me tell you, this takes a whole lot of humility, that when season like that comes to your life, that you approach it with wisdom. Yeah, that you approach it with Jesus. And don't forget, brothers and sisters, that even this season we're talking about does not last forever. Seasons always changes. Hallelujah, seasons always changes. That's why there are people that God has brought into our life that God expects to stay with our life, irrespective, you know, of the season we are. And that is what Barnabas and Paul relationship is supposed, you know, to be like. It's supposed to be like. Hallelujah. One of the grace for this season is that God is restoring old bridges, you know, restoring old bridges. That relationship that formed by, you know, there are some of us listening to the sound of my voice right now, that the relationship you have lost, you've not been able to find replacement for it. That there are people in your life that they are so much affected you, do you understand? That even where you are right now, you might have achieved or entered into a new season of your life, but you know that there is an ingredient in this guy, there's an ingredient in this lady that you have not found a replacement with. It takes humility for you to go back and say, let's realign it together, let's redefine this relationship. I need you in my life, you need me in your life, and let's move together. That is the essence of you know, godliness. That's the essence, you know, of destiny. Are you with me? So don't forget, dealing with changing season and status in relationship is very vital. Hallelujah. It's very vital, very vital. So there are about three or four seasons in the relationship of Paul and Barnabas. Now, the first season is season where Barnabas went to seek for Paul and brought him. The second season was when both of them were prophets and teachers in Antioch, and they were preaching the gospel, and was fantastic. They called them Christians. For them to call them Christians together, that means that they were having some level of spiritual maturity, you know, working together, which was fantastic. The third season, I'm telling you, changes in season. The third season is that when they were selected together as an apostles, the Holy Spirit said, "Separate me, Paul and Barnabas." Listen to me. If the Holy Spirit joined people together, come on, what else do you want? The Holy Spirit joined them together, and they entered into their third season, and they went, you know, into the world preaching the gospel, and they began to face some different dimensions of challenges ministerially this season now. And by the time they came back, they now enter into the another season of their life, and now this season now, the season whereby it was so visible that the ministry of Paul has matured. The ministry of Paul has so matured now that it was Paul now, in the scripture we read now in Acts chapter 15, verse 13, it was Paul now that is saying to Barnabas. Barnabas wasn't saying to Paul. Paul was saying to Barnabas, "Now let's go back to the brethren, to every city we've been to, so that we can strengthen them more in the Lord." So the intention of Paul at this point now is that he's leading the campaign. Before, it was Barnabas leading the campaign. In fact, I can give to you, you know, Acts chapter 13, verse 47. You will see written there, you know, let me back up. Acts chapter 13, verse 12. Bible says, "Now separate me, Paul and Barnabas." When the Holy Ghost was speaking, he said Paul and Saul. He didn't say Saul and Paul. You must understand the pattern. It was Barnabas and Saul. By the time they got to Acts chapter 13, verse 43, the order has changed. Not only has Saul changed to Paul, it is now Paul and Barnabas. Not Barnabas and Saul, it is now Paul and Barnabas. By the time you get to Acts chapter 13, verse 50, it is Paul and Barnabas. Are you with me? By the time you get to Acts chapter 14, verse 14, then you see again apostles, Barnabas and Paul, you know, when they wanted to worship them in a city. Now, by the time you get to Acts chapter 15, verse 35, it is now Paul and Barnabas. So, the counsel of God is that the highest auction of that path, the auction of that assignment, the purpose of that relation, because God puts people together for a purpose, there is always an assignment that God wants to achieve through men, that it causes him to synergize people together. Did you understand that? There's always an assignment that God wants to achieve. It uses our personality to connect us, our giftings and our maturity to keep us together. But the benefit of God in every relationship is that he has a purpose to achieve. And the purpose might not be ministry like this. The purpose might be, you know, building generational families together, running businesses together. And whatever the purpose is, while you are approaching the purpose, day after day, seasons and status will always change. How you manage season and status in relationship will automatically help us to know how we can sustain that relationship. Are you still with me? So as far as Paul is concerned now, you know, in this case now, in Acts chapter 15, verse 35, Paul and Barnabas. So it seems to us that Paul was leading the team at this point. It seems as if the light was shining more on Paul at this season. And when Paul now said in verse 36 of Acts chapter 15, Acts 15, 36, Paul now said to Barnabas, it's Paul that said Barnabas. He said, "Barnabas, let's go on a mission. Let's go back to the places we've been to and let's preach the gospel." And I'm telling you, the believers that were once called Christians began to fight. Oh boy, they began to fight, and you must see the expression. This was hot. Let me bring to you, as I tie this together, apostles as well. I'm talking to you now. I don't want to go this a little bit deeper as I talk to about the body of Christ, because we're in a season right now in the body of Christ that apostles are what? At war. Apostles are what? and if people are connected together by divine, if God says, "Separate me, Paul and Barnabas and Saul, for the assignment I've given to them," and they have issue, what will you say to even apostles that put, you know, that God has called differently, and they are finding it difficult to synergize, to push the work of God or the kingdom of God to the next level? You see that this is a very serious matter. That relationship is key. No matter how anointed is we are, if we don't understand the dynamics of relationship, we can fail in the assignment of God over our lives. Yeah. No matter how anointed, gifted a man, if you don't appreciate the dynamics of relationship. I did a research, a bit of study about men and women that serve God, that has dynamic anointing. You know, generations past, you know, men and women that are so gracious. One of the things that was noted about them, that I note about them, is that they live their end of years in isolation. Nobody close to them, nobody clear to them, you know, nobody serving them at their old age. In other words, people approach them based on their giftings, not interested in their individual lives. And that's why I said last Sunday that the people you keep at your 30s, the friendship that God brings your way, that you manage, that you sustain, are the relationship that are useful for you in your 60s. You might not appreciate the importance of friendship now, but I'm speaking to you, though, as a young man, I'm speaking to you about the importance of future. That it is possible for a man, when you see our fathers, you know, retired and they died early at the age of 60, and by 70 they are gone, is because they cannot live 10 years of their lives doing nothing and no relationship in their lives. And relationship is not a gift at old age. It's something, and no matter how close you are to your children, by the time you're old, your children cannot be your best friend. And that's the funny thing about relationships. They are born mothers and fathers, that you ignore your spouse and you develop relationship with your children. You can do it when they are teenager, you can do it. But by the time they get married, you discover that you are not at the same level. You must learn to build relationship, accept, assimilate, build up relationship for your own individual life. And I said last Sunday that you might be open or exposed to about 150 people. In fact, they say human brain has ability to sustain about 150 relationships, but it's important for you to know that you cannot. If you are gifted with 5 friends in your entire life, you are a special man. You are a very special man. Because today now, you might think you have friends here and there. I did it last Sunday to test your relationship. It will shock you that one, if a test enter into your relationship, a change in season and status. A change in season and status. I'm telling you, we know that what you have is not a friend, it's an acquaintance. That what you have is not a friend, it's a brother, which is fantastic. Okay, that what you have is not a friend, is a colleague, is a ministerial partner. Hallelujah. But we have to allow God to test our environment, to test people in our life. And this decade is very vital to that. Even as an individual, my job this decade is to be sure that the people that are in my life are very important to my life. They are relevant to my life. They are relevant to the new season or any season I am in my life. For instance, now last week Sunday, I was talking to one of my friends. This guy, I met him in university. You know, and among the crowd of people that were on campus, I just cited him. There was nothing natural about him that is comely. Hallelujah. You know, his bag is like that of a Jehovah's Witness, but I've even been listening to me like this. Very simple guy, but I could see that there is something about this guy. And we became friends. This guy, we pray together, we did together. I love him. I love his sincerity. I'm telling you, this guy, you know, we not hide things from me. We tell me this, what I'm feeling. And I discovered that over the years, I didn't struggle to respect him. Irrespect or mutual respect, irrespect what we passed through. Now, there have been change of status, there have been change of season. Do you understand? It's, you know, I'm more into meaning sweet than he is, you know, and all of that, but the respect is still mutual. So I called him last week, and I was just talking to him. Oh, how are you doing, brother? You know, friend, ministry wise, whatever, you know, accountability relationship, you know. And in the course of doing that, he releases it, he just made a statement, and that statement was an encouragement, brother, that I've been looking for. I need that somebody to just encourage me with a statement. When the public says Hosanna, it doesn't make sense. It's only a man that is not wise that rejoices at the sound of the public. When public social media, everybody shout, oh, I love you, you're great, listen to me. It's not you that you really love, it's your giftings they love. It's only friends that loves you and they genuinely mean it. I'm telling you, just look, you can have 100% dimensions of manifestation right now. People will love you, but it is very difficult for you to distinguish whether the love they have for you is for who you are or for what you have. Both of them are important, but they have different priorities. But the purpose of friendship is that people that stick with you irrespective of seasons. There are people that stick with you. These are the people that, even when your time is up, they are the people that will keep and pay attention to your children. Those are friends. There are people like Benson, the other of blessed memory. When the man was alive, a lot of people were enjoying his gift globally. But by the time the man of God went to be with the Lord, the university and all of that were facing challenges. There are people that were paying the school fees, they were paying, you know, the salaries of teachers, sponsoring the assignment he left over. after he has gone. Those are friends. Those are people that you can call confident. Are you with me? And until you pass through some season of your life, challenge of your life, you won't appreciate that. So as far as you know, Paul and Barnabas is concerned now, they enter different seasons and status in their lives. Men, different, and I'm telling you, the apostle sent them to. I am praying for the body of Christ this season, that the people that God has connected together, that are vital to the end time assignment. We will not serve God separately. We serve God unanimously. Are you with me? Are you with me? One of the things that is very, very scarce in the body of Christ, if I might delve into this a little bit, is that it's so rare for you to see apostolic partnership. You can see pastors working with prophets, even though that's even a struggle. Apostolic partnership. And that was the intention of God. Initially, God, no separate, no Paul, you know, and Peter and John were doing it for the Jews, and God wants to do the same pattern, for the Gentiles. So he separated Barnabas and Paul. In other words, he wants people that have operated in the peak of their calling and capacity and launch them into the waters and shame the world system. When the two of them get into a land, the people will say, oh, these are gods, and they will want to worship them. That's the kind of auction. Bible says, one will chase 1,000, two will chase 10,000. That's the kind of auction God is bringing on relationship. People that mature, but come to discover that when people mature into the fullness of their calling, into the fullness of the grace of God, into the fullness of their ability, you have entered into the jackpot of your destiny. You've gotten to a point whereby your ministry, your businesses will blossom, your family has gotten to the highest level. You begin to have a sense of independence. You just feel that you don't need much people. And indeed, you don't need much people, because it's that time you enjoy your life. You can do anything you want to do. You don't need relationship. In fact, what you have at that point is enough for you. But that's not always the agenda of God. The agenda of God is that when you have the ability to get to the height, it can take you from that height and push you to another height. And it does that by intimate relationships. Are you with me? So we must learn to know how to deal with people and how to deal and handle principles. Are you with me? Let me tie this together, brothers and sisters. And I talk to you about 7 things that could bring out, from the relationship between Peter, between Paul and Barnabas, and things that we should be aware of. 7 things, briefly, that we should be aware of. And it's important for us to be aware of this so that it can help us to handle, seasons and status, that comes in to test relationships in our lives in different levels. Number one is that if that relationship matters, you have to humble yourself and honor it continuously. Mark my word, if that relationship matters, you have to learn to humble yourself and honor that relationship continuously. Because it is honor that erases familiarity in relationships. You must learn to honor. Listen, Apostle Selma was just saying in a meeting yesterday that if you cannot honor people for what they will do for you or doing for you, you must learn to honor them for history, for what they have done for you. If there's any reason Paul needs to honor Barnabas, he needs to honor him because he brought him to the limelight. If you understand, listen to me. If Barnabas did not seek for Paul and bring him to the limelight, who else in the body of Christ has at that time we have capacity to do it? Because sometimes now season changes and you feel that you are now better. and you have forgotten that what qualifies you to be better is as a result of somebody that brought you to the limelight. Are you listening to me? And this is not just in ministry, it's in every aspect of your life. I've seen people sit down together for an interview. A guy wanted to go for an interview. He called his friend. He said, they are calling me for an interview. Will you go with me? They got him for the interview. The guy they called for interview didn't get the job. The friend they invited got the job. The question now is that there's tendency for you to feel that, boy, I'm the one that has the anointing. He just invited me and they gave me the job. Can you see God's hand is upon my life? Yeah, I believe God is upon your life. But how do you treat that brother that didn't get the job that you got, because he invited you? Humility and honor. Honor is not a gift. No, honor is not a gift. Honor is you placing the right value over a thing. Are you with me? Honor, you place the value of a cup is different from the value of a phone. Are you with me? If you pick a cup that you trade down, you know that if the cup get broken, all you just need to totally look for £5 thereabout and buy another one. But you won't do that to a phone because you know the value difference. Placing the right value over a thing is an honor. And God is the one that imposes honor. When he created the man, he places honor on man. It's the honor of dominion. He places, when he brings people into your life, he places honor on them. The honor on them is their capacity and their ability and their assignment in your life. And it's responsibility to continuously familiarity in relationship, it can endanger a lot. Honor people. It doesn't respond just to age. It responds to values. Have you ever met somebody in your life that you know that anytime you need the truth, they will always tell you the truth? Anytime you need somebody to look at you face to face and say, brother, you're right, brother, you're wrong, you honor them for that, because that is the assignment in their life. So if that relationship matters, we must humble ourselves, and honor the relationship continuously. Hallelujah. And this is a message to every Barnabas in our generation, that when people grow up, people under us, they are more interested in advice, not just in command. And we can see it in this scripture that we just read now. Because as far as Barnabas is concerned, the Bible says he insisted, he was determined. In other words, he has added emotional attachment to this thing and said to me, I'm bringing your mark with me. There's nothing you can do. He made a conclusion, because he's so used to, probably might be used to saying, when I speak, Paul listens. But in this aspect, Paul has an ideology, he has a contribution to give. So as a result of that, you cannot afford to insist. Okay, we advise, you suggest, and you allow the Holy Ghost to strengthen the second party to be able to make decisions, that is in alignment. The same way in relationship, you can't say you are just the husband, just, this is what we're going to do. Everybody, you can say, this is what God is telling me, this is what I feel we should do. And because every other person is not robots, you must give them the opportunity to pick the signals of God and say, okay, this is what we're doing. That's why when you're young, you command a child, but when we grow up, we don't command, we advise. It's very important. Hallelujah. Number two things I learned from this story, or this apostles at war conflict, is that new inflow should not break out the old flow. New inflow should not break out the old flow. I said that briefly, that we must appreciate, understand the importance that when a relationship is coming to our life, we must be able to check the value vis-a-vis the relationship that was in our lives. So if it is Barnabas that was in the lives of Paul, and now John Mark is coming in, Barnabas is a destiny relationship. John Mark is a family relationship, even though with the dimension of ministry, importance to both of them. But how do you balance the two together? If you cannot match the two together, the question is that what's the priority? As at this point now, the priority is that God has an assignment for them to do. God wants to use them in ministry. So the question now is that when there is a new, and I'm telling you, this is causing a whole lot of things. A new season of popularity can make a man to shame friends. You just draw a complaint and everybody, new status, new level. Then you just, my levels and status are changing. Then, you begin to develop new friends. The truth of the matter is that in that new status you have, that you thought you have friends, the friends that you have in that new status are attached to you because of the status, not because of your person. And God has to, if that relationship at that level is vital to your destiny, God will also test it. So that you can get to a level. That's where sometimes, you just pass through a little setback. Probably your car just broke down by the roadside. And the reason you had that is not because, God cannot fix the car or disallow that to happen. Just because God wanted to give you a chance to see who is close to you. And it amazes you that when that happens to you, that's when somebody, that is close to you will just call and say, I'm just been thinking about you. Where are you? What are you? And it was just shocking that wow. This is somebody that is interested. This is somebody that they call. I've seen this repeatedly in my life. Hallelujah. I've seen this repeatedly in my life. There are seasons that in the middle of the night I just pick the signal of somebody, a friend, here and there, and my job is to pray for them, my job is to share for them. And like a fresh water on the thirsty soul, that becomes a strong encouragement to them. That is what God wants to achieve with intimacy. That's what He wants to achieve. I was studying Jesus and Lazarus, and I discovered to myself that, look, what Jesus did to Lazarus, he couldn't do it for anybody else. He can only do that for Lazarus. There are things that God will only allow you to do for intimate friends. Are you with me? Intimate friends. You can't forget them in a hurry. You say we have friends, you talk once in 2 months. Come on, brothers. You don't pray for each other. Come on, brother. You are ashamed to share your weaknesses with each other. Come on, brother. You are with each other, you are not relaxed. You are not jovial, You are also following protocol. Hey, you can't call yourself a pet name. You have to call yourself man of God. Come on, brother. What up that way. You need intimacy, you know, in friendship. Hallelujah. So new inflows. One of the things I did before I got married, which really helped me, and I did it, you know, subconsciously, but it was very beautiful. When I wanted to get married, you know, got into a relationship, I told my wife, I said, look, my dear, I have relationship in my life that I want to bring into this marriage. I said, I have this pastor, I have this friend, I have that friend, I have that friend. I said, these guys are important to me, and I believe God brought them into my life. And as I enter into this marriage, I want them to know, to be part of it, because they are accountability, they are, we have accountability relationship. And I took my wife to go and meet them, and they, you know, familiarized themselves together. And I'm telling you, one of the brilliant decisions I made in my life. Because even my wife at that time, you know, introduced me to a pastor, and we kept that pastor in this relationship. I won't say because I'm a husband and I'm a pastor, I have the anointing of God, my wife is supposed to be my church member, I should make the final decision, and I won't allow her to have relationship with that pastor. The same respect she has for a pastor, I have the respect for the pastor, I listen to the pastor, I'm accountable to the pastor, you know, I preach for the pastor. Just mention it. This has nothing to do with how much values, you know, revelation, whatever. No. When people are important to our life, we have to learn to keep the relationship is vital. Irrespective of this change, the season and start, we have to move with them. Some ladies now, it is when you got married that you lost intimate relationship that you build up in school. It was when you had nothing that you were building that relationship. Now you got to a point whereby you change status, you're married now, you have children now, and your friend doesn't have children. Now you begin to discuss, you know, together, you know, we don't even have anything to talk about again. Because every time you talk now, you talk about babies. You talk about my husband, and you know this guy doesn't have, this lady doesn't, or this person doesn't have relationship. Listen, what brought you together should be one of the things that should keep you together. Are you with me? As at the time God brought you together, there was no man, there was no woman, there was no children, there was no job, there was nothing. you were just trying to find your way into destiny, discover purpose and all of that. And when you came together, you bound the intimacy. You know, I told you last week, statistics shows that relationship, you know, does not, cannot last. Many relationships does not last 7 years. Check the relationship in your life, how many of them that have last 7 years. And it's still intimate. That you can sit down and you talk for 1 hour, 2 hours. You know, not just sharing Bible, because when we're talking about this intimate relationship, it's not just sharing Bible says, quoting scriptures. That is fellowship. But at least be able to talk about individual, give expression of who you are, be able to realize all your life, all every day of your life you have just formed. You get to office, you're a worker. You are at home, you're a husband. Before your children, you're a father. You know, you're driving. Everything has always been responsibility here and there, defining who you are. But when you are before a friend, you are yourself, you relax. You can flow. So those relationships matters to your destiny. So as far as Paul and Barnabas case is concerned, we must learn to appreciate the importance of new flow, you know, and blending it with old flow. New flow does not necessarily cause us to expire the old flow. Are you with me? It's very important. Hallelujah. So that's very key. The value of relationship. Number three, the third thing I've learned about, you know, Paul and Barnabas syndrome is we must learn to define and analyze the root cause of the conflict. When there are conflict in relationship, it is vital for us to analyze without emotion the root cause. The root cause of the issue between Paul and Barnabas is the fact that John Mark departed. He did not leave. He didn't, you know, the scenario played here was that John Mark left. No, without consent. As in, they were just on a journey, you know, gathering resources together, moving from city to city. They sat together, they pray, Lord, we sit and we're going together, going next. And God said, this is where you should go, that is where you go. As they were trying to navigate into the next season, John Mark has already started having it in his mind that, man, I won't follow them to the next city. And immediately he saw the next ship that can go back to his homeland. He's just doing it. The Bible says he departed. That word is very powerful. He departed. It's not without permission. And that can break the heart of anybody, especially when you have been added to the resources for the next assignment. Are you with me? So we must learn to know the root cause. Even John Mark himself cannot say that he wasn't at fault, you know, as far as this is concerned. You know, so when he left, and one of the things you must appreciate about this, and is that the next city they got to, because in Acts chapter 13, verse 13, you know, John Mark left them and returned to Jerusalem. In chapter 14, the next city they got to, when they got there, Paul and Barnabas were there. That was where they stoned Paul to death. You see that now? So John Mark left, and automatically his absence created a loophole Probably somebody that should be interceding, or somebody to be, gathering information. By the time he left, the next city they got to, Barnabas was there, but it was Paul they brought out, and they stoned him, and the guy would have died there. But thank God, disciples surrounded him, he rose up, went back into the city. You know, the calling of God and the purpose of God saved him. Now, if you are to bring out the case again, and you say, let's analyze the last journey, how did it go? Let's analyze the last business trip, how did it go? And by the time the guy is analyzing and he's saying to himself, the only pain I have is that John Mark left. If John Mark is to come again, there must be a sense of acknowledgement that was wrong. There must be a sense of repentance. There must be a sense of growth. That this time, when you join us, you're not going to leave us again. If those ideologies are placed on table, as far as this issue is concerned, it would have been easier for the two of them to be on the same page. But in this case now, that was not. The root cause was done. The relationship you're in today, something that caused this issue, do you know? If the root cause is not known, it's difficult for us to find solutions to it. Are you with me? It's difficult. And one of the things about, you know, conflict in relationship is that when you begin to have one issue that is that lays the foundation, that is the cause of the conflict, if you don't address it as soon as possible, other issues begin to climb it, you know, top it up. And over the years, it's very difficult to even go back to the root cause of the issue. Are you with me? The root cause here is not that God is not calling them together. The root cause here is not that they don't love each other. The root cause here is not that they've gotten to a point whereby they said, oh, our ministry can begin to work independently. The root cause here is because there's a new relationship that came like a yeast that want to mess up the assignment of God in these people's life. So what's the root cause? Sit down and think about it. The first time you begin to have a kind of restriction as far as this relationship is concerned, what was the cause? Marital relationship today, you know, we're shouting divorce. Divorce is not the root cause. Something happened. It could just be that I called you when I needed you most. You didn't pick my call, and you're my husband, and you didn't even bother to call me back. You know, so I can't trust you. And anytime I try to call you again, it's the same thing. Then I test you in every aspect, you begin to fail the same test. So I can't trust you. And I can't trust. After 5 years, there's a betrayal of trust. I can't trust you. The root cause is just one singular call. That's where it started from. That's the root cause. What's the root cause? Hallelujah. And I'm praying today in the name of Jesus for the spirit of revelation. That any relationship that is very vital to our lives, that God will help us to know how to handle anything, any demonic seed that God is placing on it in order to cause an havoc in it. The root cause. There must be a root cause. A root cause. Hallelujah. Another thing I learned about the Barnabas and Paul syndrome is that who has the right to make the final decision per season? Don't forget I told us that change of seasons very matter. It's what one of major change of season and status. Is the major, I can't stop saying it. Changing seasons and status is one of the major vital things that affect relationships, you know, that test relationships. And when it comes, it's important for us to know that who has the right to make the final decisions. Who has the right? Don't forget that it was Barnabas' decision to go and look for Paul and bring him to Antioch. It was the Holy Ghost's decision to separate Paul and Barnabas. As far as the new assignment is concerned, are you with me? It's Holy Ghost decision. As far as moving into this new assignment, it was Paul's decision. As we read it, Paul said, let us go back to the place where we are preached so that we can preach the gospel back to them. Are you with me? So who has the right to make the final decision? Who wants to listen to what I'm about to say? Whosoever carries the frontline mantles is who the eternity will support. Whosoever carries the frontline mantles. It's who the Italian. One of the things about God is that God has only one interest in any relationship he sees under the heavens. The only interest he has is fulfillment of the gospel, the kingdom mandate, kingdom advance. But that's all he wants. That's all God wants. And as far as this season is concerned, the mantle was on Paul. But Barnabas was a partnership in training the mantle and manifesting the mantle. So this season now, as far as Paul is concerned, is fully matured into the ministry. Probably just been praying when they go back to Antioch, he just be praying and say, God, what's the next assignment and whatever that. And Barnabas was not even doing that. Even if he's doing that, God wasn't speaking to him at that point. It was God that God was inspiring and creating a new body in the heart of Paul. And Paul stood up and said, oh, guy, no, let's go back and do this together. You know, in relation we're in today, when we want to make decisions, before we make the final decision, we have to understand who has the right to make the final decision. The assignment is what is critical to God. If the assignment is on Barnabas, it would have continued the story of the book of Acts. Hallelujah. The light we always press on the predominant call. So the call was on Paul. That's why, and I'm, let me say this at the point. My job with this discussion is not to underestimate Barnabas in any way, because some of us will be very easy to say to us, oh, excuse me, Barnabas missed it, Paul made it. That's why the story. The reason the story of Paul continued, as far as this concept is concerned, is because as far as the searchlight of heaven is concerned for that season, it was Paul that God is using for the Gentile. That does not mean the ministry of Barnabas was irrelevant, but it was not really, it was not relevant for the limelight. The goal of God at that time is to accelerate, to generate kingdom advancement to the Gentiles. And that was what Paul carries. But for you to say, you know, as a believer, you must, you know, it's so easy for us to say, oh, I don't miss him. Paul Barnabas is gone. It's my personal ideology, but personal perspective. But studying the ministry of Paul, which is difficult to say publicly because there are a whole lot of Paul's discipling disciples that they don't even want to see any, you know, any exemptions to the assignment, because they believe that, and I believe to this, a great man that achieved, you know, a lot in the gospel. But I know definitely, and you might, you should know too, if you have the Spirit of God in you, that there are a whole lot of, there are things that Paul would have achieved more frequently or more stable in his ministry if Barnabas retained what was the same as far as the team is concerned. Yes, definitely. You can't compare Barnabas' call with Silas. No. You can't compare the two. It's different. It's different. And it's so visible here that it was not God's intention for them to be parted. Hallelujah. It's so visible. So who has the right to make the final decision? Definitely in this case, it was Paul. I believe that has the right. So in your relationship, who has the right to make the final decision? You know, it's so simple. This thing can be so simple. For instance, that somebody wants to get married and is your close friend. If it's your close friend, you should choose the kind of marriage you want to do, the wedding you want to do, the venue. If somebody wants to celebrate birthday, is your friend, but why would you make the final decision for his birthday? Because it's your friend, and you are not angry because you didn't make the final decision. My wife wants to say, my wife will be, you know, we'll be celebrating her birthday anytime soon. You know, praise God for my wife. She'll be 14 October. You know, wisdom demands that I don't tell her this is how the wedding should be done. This is how the birthday should be done. It's not my responsibility to decide how she wants it. It's a birthday. She has the right to make the final decision. And there are many relationships that have been confused as a result of that simple thing. So he Paul is saying to Silas, let's go and touch this other country, places we're going. It should determine who to make the final decision. Come on. It's as simple as that, but we don't pay attention to that. Sometimes it's very difficult for us to just believe, you know, I advise him, I said this, listen to me. Whosoever God calls must make the final decision as far as they call. All we can do is to advise him to sit and trust God that they're able to do it right. But we can't stop that. We can't stop them from doing it. You know, there was a couple, you know, my wife was sharing with me the Wills and Wills and Will Smith's married. That's the one of the, you know, celebrities. We're talking about one of the things that causes the breakdown in their marriage, though they are together now, you know, by the grace of God, doing well. You know, I just want to bring that out. I listen to celebrities because you know that celebrities have a whole lot of issues. Publicity, public life is different from private life. I'm telling you, it's different, and you have to be strong with your private life, you know, to be able to back up your, you know, strong with your private life for you to be able to back up your, you know, public life. Now, this is one of the things that he said, you know, the wife was saying that, he said one of the things that caused havoc at that point in their marriage was that they entered a change of season whereby with any money they have, everything, bam, was available. Now, the wife now wanted to celebrate birthday, and the husband make the final decision how the birthday should go. She arranged everything day by day and sponsor everything. And the woman was saying in her heart, it's my birthday. Let me do this the way I wanted it. And I'm telling you, it got to a point that, he was even smacking the body for days. Got to a point that she couldn't even cope with daily, no program as far as the body is concerned, because it was a body, not his body. But by the time they sat down together years later and they're able to mend the relationship, one of the things he was saying, that he has an issue with pride, because everything about that body was just about, you know, boosting his ego. He just wanted to prove that he has money and capacity. And in relationship is not a place to secure you have rights, you know, and stuff like that. It's a privilege. It's a privilege. So whoever, you know, is making, you know, is carries the vision, carries the goal, is the one that should make the final decision. I saw this in this, and this has taught me a lot of things. For instance, I'm talking to friends now, and they're telling me that this is what they want to do. This is the assignment of God upon their life. I can have ideas how they can do it, but my goal is to ask them, how do you want to do it? If you say this is what you want to do, that's what you want to do, then I will now say, okay, let me have this advice to you. You might take it and stuff like that. And whatever advice or whatever decision they make, the proof of friendship is my ability to support them, even though it wasn't my idea. Do you understand what I'm saying? That's what relationships is all about. So that when people come to us as friend relationship and bring things on the table, we don't turn to prophet Agabus immediately and begin to tell them, thus said the Lord upon that one. If that issues or that concept or that vision is very, very vital to us, and God is, you know, God wanted us to be there 100% to lead the role in that vision, He would have spoken to us. But if God didn't speak to Barnabas and decided to talk to Paul, and Paul said, okay, let's go back to where we've been and let's do this work together, then he suggests to us that Paul should make the final decision. I do understand what I'm saying. I'm using this case study to better us, to let us understand that no matter your height of calling, even as an apostle, apostles also go to war, and we must learn in our lives to deal with conflict, praise God. So now, who has the right to make the final decision? And that's in the land. Oh, this is very powerful. This is very powerful. I'm tidying this up now. This is very powerful. Glory to God. You know, Bible says Barnabas, determined to go with John Mark. Paul insisted that he's not going to go. In any relationship or conflict, in conflict management, we must watch our language in this dispute. In fact, that's very key. No matter how boiling the issue is in our inside, we must watch our expression. Do you understand that? We must watch our expression. We must learn to calm down with what we say, even though we are boiling within. You know, the word, look at the word Barnabas, say he's determined. To be determined, it says, I am doing this whether you agreed or not. And probably would have thought that once he make up his mind, that's what he's going to do, then Paul is going to say, okay, let's go about it. But unfortunately, it didn't go this way. Okay? It became a sharp argument, and when things like that happens, we must be careful the language we use. No. You can, this relationship matters to your life. You cannot call it any language. You can't call it, because we have a singular challenge. I'm not sure it's my friend again. It shouldn't come out of your mouth. Do you understand what I'm saying? You can't use that. Watch the language. You know, Barnabas, proposed. You know, he planned with full resolve. In other words, something that he has been thinking about. You know, he was thinking about it. He knew that he might come to play that Paul might want to reject, and so John Mark is not going with us. But the guy has made up his mind. That's what that word means. He has resolutely planned that he's going to go with John Mark. Hallelujah. And I remember a scripture, and I quoted it earlier, when the brothers of Jesus and his mother came to meet him, and they said, you know, your mother and brother seeks you. Jesus made a statement and said, who is my brother, who is my father, who is my mother? He said, those that does the will of God. I like the way Message Translation put it. He said, obedience is stronger or thicker than blood. I like that. You know, we always say in African dialect, no, Ali, that blood is thicker than water. That's one level. There's a water level in relationship. There's a blood level relationship. But Jesus was saying in Message Translation that scripture, he said, obedience. He said, whosoever does the will of the Father, he said, that's my family. That's my brother. That's my sister. He said, obedience is thicker, you know, than blood. So in these circumstances now, it's obedience that was more important, you know, as far as the assignment is concerned, not just personal relationship, family relationship, you know, and stuff like that. And I'm telling you can see it in the book of Proverbs. There is a friend that always stick closer than a brother. Yeah, there are friends, and we can see that in this guy, that there are friends that can stick closer. So we must watch our language. Hallelujah. It's only the will of God that can drive, you know, that we drive this one can be right. When you say, I am determined to do it, make sure you are saying, I am determined to do it, because God gave you the ordination, the right, and the ability, the capacity to do that. You can't use the word, I am determined, or insist in a relationship. No. When the other party is not accepting the ideology. You understand? You must sit down to analyze the issue, to ensure you get to the same page. And when you are not on the same page, suspend the discussion and grow spiritually, or relax a bit, you know, cool off a bit, then come back on it. Because it's possible for you to still be close when you are not in agreement with a singular decision. That's what friendship is all about. Are you with me? As far as Paul is concerned, though Barnabas proposed in his mind, but Paul think it good, He considered it worthy to reckon as worthy, no matching value with actual substance. That was what Paul is saying, that look, with this, with what this guy did, it's not possible, it's not advisable, you know, for us to do this. Watch your words in relationship. Watch your words, especially when there is conflict. Watch your word. Be careful. Don't forget what that brother, that friend, that brother, that sister has done for you, how they have added value to you in type of. Watch your language in dispute. That is very key as far as this conflict resolution is concerned. Let me add one more to it. You know, sometimes when there are conflict relationships, it's always good for us to bring a third party or an audience to weigh our decision. Because on the long run, it is not only the two of us in conflict that has the Holy Ghost. We must bring in a third party to weigh our decision. The future is always stronger than the conflict. So our responsibility is, the Bible says, when a brother offends you, you know, bring, you know, talk to him. If he doesn't listen, get the third party, bring it on the table. And if he doesn't listen, then you report him to the church and all of that. So it's important for us to learn to bring a third party. As far as this case is concerned, it was so visible that Paul brought in a third party, but Barnabas did not. How do I know? It's right there in the scripture. As far as Bible is concerned, the Bible says, and Barnabas took, mark the word took. He took and John Mark and left. To took means I'm not considering any other, you know, advice. This is the singular choice I'm making, I'm going. But Bible says Paul chose Silas. To choose is a different dimension. To choose, Bible says he chose Silas, you know. Let me read that scripture to you. Bible says, and Paul chose Silas and departed, being commended by the brethren to the grace of God. Can you see now? So as far as the body of Christ in that location is concerned, they supported the cause of Paul. It shows others. In other words, Paul was praying, okay, I need somebody to partner with me as I move into this dimension, but I need you guys to confirm this decision of mine. So Barnabas said, I'm taking John Mark. I don't care what anybody say, I'm going. But he said, I'm choosing this guy. What do you have to say? And everybody said, okay, this is a fantastic decision you need to make. And we commend you to the grace of God. And was able to continue, you know, the journey. Is that not amazing? And we can see on the long run, even though we might not see Barnabas on the picture again, it's so pathetic, it's so painful that what matters to you, what's important to you, what is unique to your life, you know, you can't sustain it for a long time. And I'm praying today. This is my prayer today. This is what I'm longing for today. I know that this is not something some people might want to hear as far as the Sunday, you know, Sunday service or Sunday message is concerned. Listen to me. Friendship is core in relationship. Friendship is core in marriage. Friendship is core in ministry. Friendship is core in every facet of our lives. We must learn to build more. We must learn to handle conflicts as far as our relationship is concerned, because it will come. It will come. These guys that we use as a case study, they are guys that they have entered into the climax of their calling, apostles. And today we have a lot of apostles that, you know, don't let me even go into such dimension, enter into the full dimension of their life, but they don't have some dimensions of respect for each other, for one another. Hallelujah. The people that are supposed to work in a team, if they work individually and you can see the mightiness of the move of God in their lives, you know, across the generation, what will happen if they are together? Because one will share 1,000, two will share 10,000. It's one of the things that God is saying to us as the body of Christ. They want to take us to a point whereby there's a level of partnership, you know, that God is bringing to us in the body of Christ that gives us an ability to advance speedily the counsel of God in the kingdom. Hallelujah. We're not wasting a generation. Somebody say, I belong to Paul, I belong to Barnabas, I belong to, you know, Apollos. Do I belong to Jesus? God is raising people, you know, do you understand, that they are vocal about, you know, accepting, they are vocal about acknowledging, they are vocal about respect, they are vocal about all knowing what other people are doing. Do you understand? They're even similar to what we're doing, what they are doing. That is where God is taking the body of Christ to. And I'm telling you, we have to learn to manage people in principle as far as our assignment is concerned. Let me pray. Then the name of Jesus, that has been my craving, that God will give us grace for reconciliation and restoration. That if there's any relation in the body of Christ, partnership that changes status and season are separated, that God in this mercy will begin to give us grace to connect back. There will be reconciliation, there will be restoration. I'm praying that there will be a new connection and a new level of love, that the past will become the past, the future will be together in the name of Jesus. We are receiving grace upon relationship for mutual honor in the name of the Lord Jesus. Grace for mutual honor in the name of Jesus. Every assignment that has been lost as a result of conflict in relationship, in family, God in his mercy will begin to realign us again for divine partnership in the name of Jesus. Lift up your voice and praise God in 1 minute right now. I don't know which relationship that matters to your life that you have not been able to assess, or you have been able to assess and ignorance and growth and change the season and status have caused us to separate. Listen to me, no matter how high you are, it's a matter of time. You need people, and when God gives you these people as a gift to your life, you must pay the price to keep them. Receive grace right now to keep relationship that matters to you in the name of Jesus. Even when they are running away from you, you will run towards them. They want to keep you, that you matter to my life, you matter to my destiny. Are you listening to me? Lekosa prantosa kataba, eko brakosa legedebosha, egebregedebosha kapa. We are praying for increase in grace or intimacy, increase in grace, oh God, for partnership in the body of Christ. That people will not be looking for others and be looking for how to join relationship just because of what they will get, but because of what they will give. In the name of Jesus, that God will be raising men and women together. They will be confident to share their partners with new men and women. In the name of Jesus, God is raising men and women that will be able to give other people their passion and ability to speak, not necessarily by because they are joining their group or they are becoming sons and daughters. No. You can, God can help you to ask, God can use you to assist people without necessarily, you know, looking for a cordial son servant relationship with them, because it's an ordination of God that your platform is given to you so that you can cause all men to come together, the body of Christ, so that they can, anyone gifted must be able to have access to your pulpit, to your ability. I'm receiving grace today as an individual, as a church, and I'm receiving grace with you today in the name of Jesus, that relationship that matters to your life will not elude you in the name of Jesus, that God will rise up day after day by his mercy upon your life. When you sleep, when you wake up, God will begin to stir up inside of you capacity to rise up and to remain connected with humility and honor with people and relationships that matters to you in the name of Jesus. You will not give up on that relation because of season. In the name of Jesus, they might despise, might look down on you, but because you love that brother, you love that sister, you're interested in that relationship, God will give you grace to be patient and to stick with it. And by the time your season is over, they will appreciate you more for even standing still, respecting and valuing them in the name of the Lord Jesus. I pray God's blessings upon you over this week, that you will live in the fullness of God's intention. The cities will open to you. Grace will be abundance upon your life. God will keep you in good day. Yes, that's for some. But God will keep you in good air. And whatever is causing fear of hurt in your life, we rebuke it in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. You will not be afraid of your hurt in the name of the Lord Jesus. I command the spirit of joy to continually pour on you revelation, that you might be able to have stamina to stand feet, to stand to your feet, doing the will of God. Yes, there's somebody that understand my voice. Yes, you are struggling to make a decision that glorify God. I am praying for you today that the spirit of joy will rest upon your life. Yes, the spirit of joy. The spirit of joy is what brings revelation. And when revelation is upon your life, revelation rather brings the spirit of joy. When joy is in your heart, it has your ability to stay with God, irrespective of what is happening on the external. In the name of Jesus, you will not fail in the assignment of God upon your life. In the name of Jesus, receive grace, receive capacity, receive ability to do the will of God for your life. In the name of Jesus. I want to appreciate you today. Thank you for joining the broadcast. We love you. Please share this message. Let somebody know about the Influence Church. I know this is a new assignment, but I'm telling you, God is helping us run this assignment for this decade, and it's going to be great day after day. God is adding to us. If you want to learn anything from us, you want to be part of what God is doing, you want to volunteer, and I'm trusting God, you understand my voice, you want to learn the heart of prayer, you know, please just go to our page and WhatsApp us. We'll be able to take it over from there. Want to thank you for being part of this broadcast, and we're praying that this week is going to be good for you. God is going to bless, your family, it's going to bless your spouse. There's a man here, you're having issue with that. Diabetes. Eliambo Ho said, you're having issue with that. A man, you're having issue with diabetes. I rebuke that sickness in the name of Jesus. Your fear is that you're going to die young. You're not going to die young. God is going to deliver you. Stick yourself to the service of God. Don't run away from serving God. Stick yourself with it. God is going to heal you in the name of, you're having a guy, you're having young in your 40s. You're having issue with diabetes. God is sending a word to you today. Don't give up. It's going to heal you. It's going to strengthen you. in the name of the Lord Jesus. Thank you, precious Father. Hallelujah. We love you guys. We appreciate you. Please enjoy a wonderful week. Keep safe, keep healthy, and the Lord will continually strengthen and uphold you in Jesus' name. Again, my name is Deepa Panchile with Pastor Ezeflin Church here with my wife right here in Shadam Medway of the United Kingdom. Hallelujah. Please get in touch with us. Ask any questions, any query, any prayers. Just let us know. We'll be glad, you know, to be of help to you in any way we can by the grace of God. God bless you. Have a wonderful week. Bye for now.